Welcome to H2K Infosys. H2K Infosys is a e-verify business based in Atlanta, Georgia, United States. We provide 100% job-oriented, instructor-led, face-to-face, true live online software training programs. It also includes access to cloud test lab with software tools. We provide live project for you to work on. We also provide assistance with mock interviews, resume preparation and review, and job placement assistance. H2K Infosys is trusted by so many students across the world. H2K Infosys provides world-class services in IT training with real-time project work for corporates and individuals, special IT training for MS students in the United States, software design, development, QA manual and automation, performance testing and maintenance, IT staff augmentation, job placement assistance and tech support.
Hello. Hi, Smita, are you able to hear me?
Yes, Jerome, I can hear you.
Okay. Hi, guys. A very good evening. And
good evening to you, too.
Yeah. And, okay. Give me a sec. All right, guys. So, can I just know who are there in the call right now?
This is Rohit.
Hi, Rohit. Rohit, in short, can you just give me some a bit of your introduction also, so that we can proceed one by one?
No.
Hello. Hello. Snigdha, there seems to be some problem with the call.
No, I can hear you. Hello, participants, can you hear the faculty? Can you listen to the faculty? Yes.
Is it something like their voice is muted? For that reason, they're not able to hear?
Yes, but they can unmute and talk.
Okay.
Participants, please give your introduction. Please unmute yourself and give a very short introduction as in your name and what background you are from. Thank you.
Hello, Jairam. You can go ahead, Jairam. Okay, we are audible to you. So you can please introduce yourself and you can go ahead, okay?
I'm from the H2K Infosys. And today we are just going to learn about Java. Just before that, let me just try to introduce on what H2K Infosys is all about. So H2K Infosys is basically an e-verify and business based. It is based in Atlanta, Georgia, United States, and it mainly provides the online IT training service worldwide. And the website is your h2kinfosys.com, and you can see the information here, the phone number and the email. Okay. So H2K Infosys, what it does, it provides the world class service in IT training with the real time faculty and the real-time projects also for corporate and individuals as well, okay? And it's special IT training for MS students also in US, and it helps in software designing, development, QA manual, automation and performance testing and maintenance, okay? And it does in IT staff augmentation and job placement assistance and tech supports also. So today we are just going to learn about Java. Just before that, I just want to get introduced to the folks, to the participants. If one by one can give your introduction on what's the background, in short, what's the background, and can just introduce yourself, that will give me a feel of to whom I'm talking to actually. So can we start with from Kirti, please? Hi, Kirti. You're able to hear me? Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, Kirti. Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, I was in mute. Yeah, I recently graduated. I mean, I did master's in computer science. I want to refresh my skills, so that's why I'm joining this course.
Okay. Yeah. Great. Thank you. Can we go ahead with Keith? I hope I have spelled it properly. Hi, Keith. Okay, I think Keith has some problem with his audio. So Krishna, can you please go ahead?
Hi, this is Krishna. Actually, more than 15 years IT experience. Currently, I'm working as a project manager, but my background is a mainframe. So now I have need to manage some Java projects. So I just want to learn the basic of the Java and understand how it works, so then it will be easy for me to manage the projects.
Yeah, that's a good idea, in fact, because even the project which I'm working on is completely on the COBOL mainframe, and I see a lot of folks even learning Java as well. Yeah, that's a good start, actually. How about Raj?
Hi, this is Raj. I'm a COBOL programmer. I've done COBOL in the past, and I need to learn Java.
Great, okay. Thank you, Raj. Sajid, how about you?
Yes, good evening. My name is Sajid. I have a background in biomedical. You know, that's just the first time I'm taking the, you know, QA and the business analyst, you know, in the Infosys. So just I want to get some more, learn more about the IT, you know, so that's why, you know, they sent me that link for the Java. So maybe I will have some more knowledge about it, you know, so.
All right, that's great. I hope you'll be having a wonderful experience with H2K Infosys. Thank you, Sajid.
Thank you.
Shalini Lawrence, can you please introduce yourself? And in the meantime, participants, please unmute mute yourself once you're done with the talk. Thanks for that.
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Hi, I'm Shalini. I did my BTech in IT. And I'm here so that I can learn some advanced Java. I have that since I did my BTech in IT, I know some core Java concepts, but the jobs are asking for advanced Java knowledge, so I'm here.
Okay. Great. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for participating. Actually. How about Sojanya?
Hi, Jairam. This is Saujanya. My background is computer science. I'm taking this class to brush up my knowledge. That's it. Thank you.
Great, thank you. It's a short introduction, in fact. Okay, that's great. Vasu, how about you?
Hi. I'm an IT consultant, but I don't have much experience in SA in Java. So I need to learn Java from basics.
Okay. Great. Thanks for introducing yourself, guys. I think I have covered everyone. If anyone is left out, please go ahead and tell their name and the introduction. Otherwise, let's move on. Okay. Okay. So the very first thing I just want to say, it's a very good experience learning Java because people from C, C++ background, they tend to learn Java because Java is completely object-oriented and it's one of the good language to learn, okay? So basically, what is Java? Okay, so what are the things we can do it in Java? And we'll try to see starting from the core Java to the advanced Java and in more advanced, what are the things we have in Java, okay? So the very first and foremost thing, what is Java? Okay. So Java is nothing. It's a programming language and computing platform. It has first been released by SN Microsystems in 1995. Okay. So there are a lot of applications and websites that won't work until you have Java installed. It's a very simple example. I mean, if you need to have a browser in order to run your browser, also you need your Java to be installed. Okay. So by default, it needs some sort of Java to be installed. And each and every places, if you see, you have Java installed in all the places, like each and every electronics items and any kind of appliances, you see Java installed. Okay. It is very simple. It is fully object-oriented and robust. Java is fast, secure, and more reliable. Okay. So it is very fast for learning also. It is very secure because Java has got a lot of security in the recent versions of the JDKs. Okay, JDK is nothing but your Java development kit. Okay, and moreover, Java is free to download. So, and you can get the latest version from java.com or from oracle.com as well. And as you know, Java has been maintained by is bought by Oracle, and Oracle is the core owner of Java right now. Okay, so Java is everywhere. Java has very vibrant open source community. So what it does, what it means is, if let's say you have any problems in your applications, or maybe you have any problems in any approach, so you can very well Google it, and you can find a lot of answers for each and every questions what you have. Okay, so Java has a very vibrant open source community. So again, if you're stuck, you will never get stuck. Always you'll be having some answers for your questions. Okay. So Java as a technology is both a programming language and a platform. Okay. So it's a platform in the sense you have got a lot of platforms. I mean, you can even develop your mobile applications and your desktop applications using Java. Okay. So this is on short, a very short introduction on what Java is all about. Okay. Now, to just start up what Java is all about, on the development end, usually you have got the Java program and you've got a compiler and you've got something to run. Okay, so we'll go in deep when we start browsing through each and every topic. This is just in higher level. If anyone have any questions, please raise your hands. Probably I'll just stop by, and otherwise anyone can ask me any questions. Okay, in between us also should not be a problem. So in order to run Java, we have got something like Java runtime environment, which basically helps you in, during runtime, it helps you in processing your program. And it has got Java virtual machine. This is the main, it's kind of a layer on top of which all your program runs. Okay. And we have got your JDK architecture. And we have got a lot of APIs in the sense, a lot of methods. Where you are from a C, C++ background, or any other programming background, you have got methods, right? So the methods are nothing but your application programming interfaces. So Java has got a bunch of programming interfaces. On top of that, you can write your own programming interfaces also. So once you are good with your core Java, okay? So Java basics, which will create a base for further learning. So it's very important, yes. It's very important for us to learn the basic of Java, because Java is a base, and on top of Java you can start learning advanced Java and more advanced Java also. Okay, and if you can see a typical structure of your typical process, how it goes, you write your Java program. For example, for the Word document, the extension is your .doc or .docx. So the same way, the extension of your Java is your .java. Okay, so what happens here, you basically compile. So we have got a compiler which compiles your .java file to your .class file. So this is basically your, we say it is a bytecode. Okay. So this is your platform independent. So platform independent in the sense what? If you are running this program and you are compiling this program in your Windows platform, you can run your application in any other platform by using this particular class file. Okay. Guys, I would request if anyone is not talking, please put themselves in mute. Yeah, I see Sajid, Shalini, please put yourself in mute. Mm-hmm. Keith and Krishna also. Okay. So this is what you have, your JVM. On top of JVM, you basically run your class files. We'll see these in depth also. Okay. So this is your typical structure of your, some information about your Java. Okay. So this is what you need to know initially, what Java is, what Java can do. Okay. All right. Any questions, guys, on a very basic understanding of Java? Is there any questions until this point to clarify? And is there anything which is really clicking your mind to ask you the questions right now?
Yes, I have a question about this Java. You know, even though I don't have any background in IT, mm-hmm. is this the same as the C++ and C language, or is it slightly different?
It is almost same. The only thing is Java is completely object-oriented. And if you know C++ is object-oriented, but you have got pointer concepts, but mm-hmm. Java doesn't even have a pointer concept.
Okay.
All right. So it is, yes. I mean, if you know C++ and C++ is bothering you, so mm-hmm. Java is the best language to learn.
Okay. And it's required any prerequisite, or because I don't have any background in IT. You know, I have the, you know, biomedical background, but okay. I recently started, you know, the QA and the business analyst. So I think I'll be able to, you know, I have little knowledge about the C++ and C. So I think mm-hmm. I'll be able to jump in and learn more about the Java, or it'll be difficult for me.
You can easily learn it. I mean, at least if you have knowledge of C++, mm-hmm. at least if you know what a programming language is. Okay. So exactly. Even if you do not know, probably yes, H2K is going to help you in now.
Oh, okay.
I mean,
thank you.
Clearing your thoughts and your queries as well. Okay.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Yes, great. All right. So when you talk about Java, whatnot, and stuff, how do you develop Java applications? Okay. In the olden days, they used to use Notepad. Or any of the, something like a Notepad, you know what is a Notepad, right? So you write your complete program in Notepad and... hello, I hear some echo noise. Sneeta, is there a Notepad? Great, I think it was, okay. Thank you guys. All right, so how do you start developing a Java? Okay, as I was saying, initial days, we had a Notepad, okay, wherein you just used to write your programming in a plain Notepad, and you used to save it in your .java file, and you used to compile it manually, and you had to run it manually, okay? So these days, there are a lot of IDEs which has come into picture, so that is our integration, your development environment, okay? So Eclipse is one of those. So what you can do is you can develop your application using your Eclipse. Even though if you guys are you guys are not from Java, or maybe from code background or any of the background, you guys must have heard this buzzword Eclipse, right? So there are a lot of editors in this market. Like we have got Eclipse, we have got NetBeans, we have got IntelliJ. So I mean, Eclipse is one of the famous IDE. First of all, it is it's a freeware. Even though you can start working with NetBeans also, that is it's again a freeware that is given by your Oracle again. And there are a lot of other IDEs whichever is good to you, you can use it. Okay. So we in this tutorial we'll be mostly working on the Eclipse itself. Okay. So to do core Java development, there is your object-oriented programming. It's object-oriented programming is the backbone of Java programming. Okay. So think anything is an object, right? Okay. If I say in this class, I'll talk about Sajid. I say Sajid is an object. Okay. So every person is an object here in this case. So whoever I talk about in Java, I talk about in terms of object. Okay. So Java data types, there are a couple of data types in order to at least understand the flow. So these are some core things which I'm trying to say here. So Java data types, so what is a data type? Something like whether it is a string or, okay, let's say Raj by itself is an object, okay? So, but Raj has got what kind of certifications or what is his education, right? So I'll just say education is kind of a data type. Okay. Now Raj has got what's Raj's height? Okay, height is also a kind of a data type, right? So we, in Java we talk about data types. Okay, so that is again one of the important concepts. Just need to understand that. And controls, how do you control it, control the flow of your programs? You have got loops. Loops in the sense it's something like let's say there are multiple participants right now. So I want to loop through each and every participant, right? So what did I do in the initial class? I went through everyone, right? I just went through starting from PHP to Vasu. So how did I do that? I did it using my loop. I mean, it's a visual loop, but it's kind of a loop, right? From starting from top to bottom, I walk through and I ask questions to each and everyone, right? The same thing, you have a loop in Java. It's the, in COBOL world also, you have got perform, right? Wherein you do a loop in that as well, right? If I'm not wrong, if anyone there, any one of the COBOL guys, they can clear me. You have something like until, right? Because I also, in my present project, I do a COBOL conversion to Java. Okay, so I have a good knowledge on COBOL also. So the COBOL guys cannot get rid of me if they are, okay. All right, so we have got handling conditions also. We can even handle a couple of conditions. We have got if conditions, if and while and stuff and all. So okay, this is while comes under your loop, okay, and you can even handle the condition using a view. Okay, so classes and objects. One of the important concepts, as I was talking about objects, okay, so there is, we have got classes and objects, right? Now, as I talk about you guys, I say here that student is a class, okay, and out of that, Kirti is an object, Keith is an object, Krishna is an object. Okay, because Krishna, Keith, and Kirti, and Miral, Raj, everyone, they are kind of an object which are derived from a class itself. Okay, because all are students for me. All right. So this is what we are going to understand thoroughly when we start learning it. And And again, something like we have got a lot of concepts. One of the important concepts is your overloading and overriding, and which helps you in your code reusability. So what is overloading and overriding? I can talk about overriding right now, but not about overloading. Okay. So overriding is something like you have some of, let's say, you have some, I mean, some properties from a superclass, okay? Something like, your parents have got some asset or maybe a car, right? So what do you do? You even use that car, but you add some extra features in the car, right? But your parents, they never added any extra features in the car, okay? So you are trying to override the existing thing which you are trying to reuse it, okay? In depth also we can see once we get into the actual topic. Okay, so no worries. Even Java has got abstract classes and interfaces. So when we talk about abstract classes and interfaces, it is completely an abstraction. So what do you mean by abstraction here? In English term, when you talk about abstraction is something like when you try to drive a car, you do not even think about a car has got a gear, car has got a steering, car has got an audio system, right? You just see car as a car, okay? You do not even think about all the inner features of a car, right? So the inner features of a car is abstracted to you. So you just think, okay, car, man, I have to buy a car, so I have to buy a car, right? I don't have to say that I have to buy a steering wheel, I have to buy this and that, right? So it's kind of an abstraction which we are building in on top of anything, okay? It is something like I say add two numbers, right? Now how those two numbers are added, you're not even concerned with that, right? You just think about adding, okay? So there is some concepts about abstraction, and we have got polymorphism, wherein, as I was saying, if your parents have got some assets, you you inherit those things, right? Okay, so child relationship in Java, something like you've got your parent and child relationship, that is what you've got your inheritance and stuff. And okay, so downloading Eclipse. Downloading Eclipse is very easy. Just you need to go to your eclipse.org and you can download it from there. Right now, if you can see the slide, you've got Ganmade. We'll be using Kepler. So that's the latest version of your Eclipse. If you just go to your eclipse.org, you can just download the latest one. Okay. So even we'll see how to install those things and how to do a setup in your system. Okay. And before that, I think you just need to install your JDK also. That's again very important. Okay. Now, what are things we can do basically in Java? Some of the interesting thing are work we can easily do it. The very first thing is, no doubt, you can write your program, and even let's say for the COBOL guys, you can write your COBOL program, but I'm really not sure if you can run multiple COBOL programs at the same time. Okay? But in Java, you can use a multi-threading wherein you can do multiple things at a time. Okay, now what do you mean multiple things at a time? It's something like you can read something and you can even write something at the same time. Okay, I mean a single person can do multiple things at the same time. Okay, so this is what about multiple threading. It's very interesting topic, guys. I mean, really, because based on your multiple threading itself, you've got a lot of topics in your advanced Java. Okay, in core Java, we'll just learn how the multiple threading works, but when it goes to your advanced Java, we are not going to use the multiple threading anywhere, but internally, the application or the implementation of your advanced Java is based on your multiple threading. Okay, so it's one of the important concepts what we should learn properly. Okay, now handle fault scenarios, exception handling. What is exception handling? Is something like you're trying to divide a number by zero. Okay, that's actually wrong. Okay, you cannot divide any of the number by zero. Okay, so you can handle those things. I mean, when you try doing something and you try to put those information in some exception handling cases, that exception handling is going to handle your issue and he is going to solve some of the issues. Okay, so this is basically known as your exception handling. Okay, and let's say suppose sometimes you try to access any of the website and the website is down, right? What do you see? You go to some other page, then that page it says that okay, there is some problem with this page, right? So somewhere the your request to a particular website is been handled by someone, right? So somewhere they might be using some kind of exception handling. Okay, and with the help of your Java, you can do your IO streams. So there is an input and output operations. It is something like you can read a file, you can write to a file, and basically it is your read and write operation. You can do it using your Java also. Okay. And we have got something like collections in Java. This is again one of the most important topics wherein you deal with the collection. Okay, so let's say a collection of fruits. I mean, I've got 10 fruits, I mean 10 apples, right? So it's a collection of apples, right? Now when I say I've got one apple, one banana and one orange, so I've got a collection of fruits. Okay, so the collection is one wherein it's really efficiently handled in Java. Okay, and if you can see, this is a typical diagram of the thread, which we will discuss more once we get into the course. Okay. All right. Any questions, guys, till now? Okay. Now, in this course, as you can see here, it is not only about hearing and nodding your head. Okay, what Jairam is saying. Apart from that, we'll be giving some problems to you so that you are going to come up with some solution out of it, and you're going to have a discussion if you have any problems not able to solve them. Okay. Now, till here, I was actually talking about the core Java. Okay, what not we can do it with the core Java, and just to add up a couple of more things. If you see any of your applications, let's say you are using Skype, right? You might have used Skype. So So what is Skype, right? It is kind of an application which has been developed, right? Now what is a WhatsApp? It's kind of an application which has been developed, right? So the same way you can develop those kind of applications using your core Java also. Okay, there is something like Swings, AWT. You can even write your beautiful programs in that, so that and you can even sell your applications using those programs, right? I mean, you can just write your application using those programs and you can use it on a daily basis also. Okay. Okay. So once you learn your core Java, next comes your advanced Java, wherein it has got more concepts in it, and it's again very beautiful actually. So we say it's our J2EE applications, that is your enterprise edition, okay, Java enterprise edition. So in that you basically learn about your servlets, JSP is an XML. Now what is a servlet? Now on a higher level, when you say gmail.com, okay, you get a page, right? That page is somewhere present in your own system, right? So when you say something like yahoo.com, right? So this page is nowhere present in your system. This is coming somewhere from your some XYZ application, right? So this is what if you see here, with the help of, I mean, in Java we'll be using servlets. And let's say for Microsoft technologies, they'll be using your ASP or ASP.NET and stuff and all. Okay. So in Java, there is something, a concept known as servlet, wherein this is going to serve your request or whatever the request you're sending it to the server, right? So somewhere if you see this application, your yahoo.com, this particular page was somewhere there in your Yahoo server. The moment you requested with your yahoo.com, you got a page saying with all these contents, right? From where did you get all these contents? It's nowhere from the server itself, okay? So we will be learning how to build up those applications in details, okay, using a servlet. So it has got some of the life cycles, some context. You can do some filters and some listeners, okay? So probably it will be very early for you to, for me to tell you all in details right now, okay? And then you've got JSPs. JSP, actually, technically speaking, JSP is nothing but your server, but JSP is one step ahead from server. Okay, so in JSP is basically, if you guys have good knowledge in HTML, you can directly write your HTML tags in your JSP itself. Okay, you can no doubt do it in your servlet also, but it will be a bit more complex for you. So that in order to get rid of that complexity, the JSP has come into picture. Okay, so again, we'll learn in more details once we get in. Now, XML. Now, what is an XML? Can anyone tell me what is an XML? Can anyone unmute yourself and tell me what is an XML? Hope no one is sleeping, right? Okay, I think I see Krishna unmuting himself. Krishna, please go ahead.
It's an extensible markup language.
Right. So what is the use of that?
To pass the variables between the applications.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right. Okay. All right. So thanks, Krishna. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Well, using an XML, it is nothing but it's kind of a tag wherein you can, if you see your HTML also, it's kind of an XML itself, right? So XML, you can customize your tag. Let's say I want a student tag, right? So for example, so let me just take the MS Paint. It is something like I want to talk about you guys, so I'll just have something like student, okay? I'm going to have something like student, and then I'm just going to say student name, okay? So this is my student name is XYZ, right? So again, I'll be just closing the student tag here, right? So this is kind of an XML for me, because I created a tag wherein it says a student, and it says student name, right? So in that I can have, I can add one more student name, right? So this is nothing but it's kind of an XML tag wherein you have got a start element and an end element always, okay? So this is nothing but it's basically used for transferring your data from one system to another system. So whenever, when we start learning your web services, so mostly you will see the XML, or suppose you want to share your application, share your data from one layer to another layer, you might be using XML also. Okay. So this is what you typically learn in your J2EE, and on top of that, you've got struts or maybe a Spring MVC framework wherein okay. So when, by simply learning servlets or JSP is not enough. Okay, you, these days there are a lot of framework which you need to learn it in order to get a good feeling of what an a MVC framework is. Okay, now this is again kind of a buzzword for you guys, might be MVC framework. So I can use a struts, I can use a Spring to build up this MVC framework. Okay, but again, JSP and servlet is always the base for learning any of the frameworks. Okay, so even though if you learn struts or your Springs, you need to have a good understanding of your servlets and JSP. Okay, so you'll be learning about the struts architecture, and you'll be using the struts stack libraries, config. There's some technical terms here wherein we'll get into in deep. Probably we'll be learning more on the Spring application. Okay. It's all the same, okay, both are your MVC architectures, okay. And yep, you can see, we can go slow, which will help you understanding the concept thoroughly and whatnot. Any questions, guys?
Hi, this is Krishna.
Hey, hi Krishna, yep.
Which framework you are going to cover in this course?
We're going to cover the Spring MVC completely.
Spring?
Yep.
Okay.
So more or less, Spring and Struts, it's all the same. Okay. But when you start learning Springs, on top of that, if you learn your Springs MVC, it'll be very, it'll be good for you. Okay. And it'll be more interesting also, because Spring Core, we'll talk about that right on the next slide. Spring Core goes with your Spring MVC. Okay. So it's one of the good combination.
Okay.
All right? Yeah, even we have the course for Spring Struts MVC also, so we can even go through that as well, right? Now, till here we have, in the previous slides, we came across Java, okay, and whatnot we can do it in core Java, right? And then we came across your J2EE applications, wherein we will be learning about Springs, JSPs, and XMLs. Okay, now why Spring came into picture? Okay, now Spring is when we start learning about core Java, okay, and we will see how the code is tightly coupled. Okay, so Spring is kind of a framework which is again built with the help of your core Java itself. So it helps in your dependency injection. Okay. It is something like you do not have to create an instance by yourself. So there are a couple of configuration files. With the help of that, it tries to inject the instance. Okay, it is something like before event. When I say, please talk here. What happens is, let's say Snigdha. What she is going to do is, she is going to inject either of one guy to talk forcefully. Okay, so it is something like the moment I say talk, Snigdha is going to inject someone over here, right? So this is kind of an injection which is going to happen using some kind of configuration, okay, which is one of the best feature in your Spring. Okay, and when you talk about Spring controller, we'll talk about Spring MVC here. Okay, Spring has got a couple of layers, right? So Spring has got like Spring Core. When you talk about Spring Core, the applications, what you do is using your Java core Java, the same thing you can do it using your Spring Core also. Okay. So like you got core Java, it has got Spring Core. Okay. So we can see whatnot we can do, and it's again one of the beautiful framework which I have ever worked on, and you'll even enjoy working on this as well. Okay, so again, Spring has got lot of layers, like Spring Core. It has got Spring JDBC. I forgot to cover one thing. In Core Java, there is something like JDBC. Now, what is JDBC? It is our Java database connectivity. So with the help of that, what you can do is you can basically hit your database. Okay, so you can hit the database, you can query the database, you can update the database, you can do all kind of CRUD operations using a JDBC. Okay, the same thing what you do it in your Oracle. So you don't have to use your any of the IDE for Oracle. Let's say you might be using your SQL developer, right? Or you're probably, if you're using MySQL, you can use your Tor, right? Or anything. So you basically fire the queries from there. So the same sort of queries, you can even fire it using your Java applications also. Okay. So how do you do that? You do it using a JDBC. Okay. So again, coming back to Spring has got its own JDBC layer, wherein with the help of your Spring JDBC, again, you can do the same operation. So what in this course we are going to see is we are going to see the JDBC, okay, the Core JDBC, the Java JDBC, as well as your Spring JDBC. Okay. At the base, both does the same thing, and on top of that, Spring JDBC takes the help of your Java Core JDBC. Okay. But they have abstracted a lot of things. When we come across your Spring JDBC, there are a couple of things you have to take care in your Core Java, in your Core JDBC. You don't have to do those things in your Spring JDBC. Okay, so it's kind of an abstraction. You don't have to do a lot of things. Okay, we'll be even giving some assignments to you guys so that you do your assignments, and then you come up with your solutions, and then we can even have a discussion on that. Okay. And yes, after learning all these technologies, one thing we are missing here, that is your ORM tool. Okay. Now you can query the database, okay, using your JDBC, okay, or your Spring JDBC. But these days, there are a lot of framework which has come into picture, right? If you can see here, we have got Hypermail, we have got MyBadis. Okay. Those are all ORM tools. Okay, there is something like you say it as an object relation mapping. There's something, if you see this XML, right? Here I have told student, student name, right? So I can even create a class out of it. I can say a student class, okay, and in the student class, I can have a variable known as, let's say, I'll just say, this is a typical way of declaring a class actually in Java. So I'll give the student, and in the student class, I can even have something like student name. I'm not giving any data type right now, or if I want to give, I can just give data type as string. It is a string here. Okay. Now, when I query the database, or let's say when you use Tor or SQL developer to query the database, you see something in the form of a table, right? The same table structure, I want to map it to a class or map it to an object in Java world. Okay. So in that case, I will use some sort of, we'll see how we can do it in your Core Java also, in your JDBC application, and we'll see how to do it in your Hibernate also. Okay. So Hibernate, what it does a mapping directly from your database tables to your Java classes or objects. Okay, so we can see how the overview of Hibernate, and we can see some sort of configurations which are really required in order to work with your Hibernate. Okay, so you can read and save data, whatnot. You can do the same thing, any of the CRUD operations you can do it using a Hibernate. Okay, so it's create, read, update, and delete operations you can do using Hibernate. Okay, and on top of that, it gives you a lot of good facilities or options to deal with the with your queries and stuff. Okay, and we have got Hibernate mappings, an example which we will be sharing along with you guys, and then we'll be again having Hibernate assignments. Okay, which again you will be coming up with your own solutions, how to deal with it. And yeah, in the course of all these sessions, in course of your JDBC, maybe your Spring or Hibernate, in between we'll be talking about a lot of design patterns. Okay. Now, what is a design pattern? Design pattern is something like somebody has already solved your problem, right? Now, when it's something like you go through a jungle for the first time, let's say there is already a path. You always take that path, right? You do not discover your own path, because you know that if you discover your own path, there'll be a lot of obstacles for you. So already there is a path defined for you. Just go through that path, right? So it's something like somebody has already solved your problem, okay? And you just need to follow a pattern, okay? So that is nothing but your design pattern, okay? So we'll be seeing a lot of design patterns also in the course. It's not about in specific we'll be talking about a design pattern course, okay? In the meantime, for every layer, I'll be telling you, okay, what pattern is this? Okay, so this will actually make you understand, okay, which is the best practice. Okay, one more thing, I mean, using a design pattern is also a best practice. I mean, you have to know which kind of design pattern you have to use at which place. Okay, so like say, I mean, we spoke about your struts or Spring MVC, right? So MVC is kind of a design pattern also. Okay. So we'll be talking about a lot of design patterns and whatnot. Okay. So this is all, and again, design pattern is nothing. Is this kind of an approach? Okay, it's not a technology. It's not anything else. It's not a programming language. It is kind of an approach which you have to take. Okay. So we'll be even discussing about the web service. Okay. Now web service is very important. Why web service is important? Can anyone tell me what is the use of web service for? Any knowledge of web service or why it is used? Can anyone tell me one? No one? Okay. All right. So what is web service? Basically, if I write my own application in Java, okay, and you write your application in, I think Krishna, if you want, you can please go ahead and tell. I saw you muting yourself.
Go ahead. Sorry.
Okay, that's fine. All right. So let's say I have written my application in Java. You have written here. There's one more application written in .NET or maybe your Python or maybe a Perl, maybe PHP or any of the application, or let's say COBOL also, right? Now, I know Java cannot interact, or Java cannot directly interact with COBOL application, okay? Or any of the other programming language, right? Or maybe C++, right? So what we do is we have got a C++ application or a .NET application. The .NET application is going to publish a web service, okay? So with the help of the web service, what I can do is I can invoke the methods on that particular application, okay? Just to give you an example here. Okay. Now, okay. So, let's say this is your Java application, right? This is something somewhere written using a Java application, and this is somewhere written in your .NET application, right? Now, what? Let's say two different things. In .NET application, there is a calculation. Okay. Some calculation is done here, right? Now this is a very crucial calculation. This, for developing this calculation, it actually took them 1 year, right? So this calculation is some scientific calculation. They have done it here. So this is around 2000 lines of code, okay? And this particular application, this calculation application, is present in the .NET application. Okay. Now, I can very well read this code. I can do the same application or same application in my Java. Okay. Again, it is going to take, let's say, .NET was not so easy. Java is pretty much easy. It took me around 8 months. Okay. But if you can see the time range, 8 months is not a small time, right? So what I can do is I can invoke the application of your .NET. So how do I do that? I cannot do it directly from here to here, from Java to .NET. What's going to happen is this particular service is supposed to be hosted in a particular place. Okay. So I'm going to publish this particular application somewhere in the net. Okay. I'm going to publish this, and what Java is going to do is Java is going to talk to this guy, okay, which is a web service, okay, and this guy is automatically going to invoke the calculation method, and it is going to give you a return type to the Java. Okay, so Java don't have to implement anything of the .NET. So everything is a web service here. Okay, so it's one of the you can web service nothing but your moving forward back and forth your XMLs. Okay, so what all the data you send it in the form of your XML, and you've got your full web services also. So web services are of again two types. One is your visual based and one is your SOAP based. Okay, sorry, you've got your SOAP and REST. Okay, so SOAP is completely your XML based, and you've got your REST also. So that you do not use an XML over there. Okay. So you have got, you even have your JSON on there. Anyways, so understanding web service architecture, we have got SOAP and Visual, and we'll be even talking about REST also. And we'll be testing the web service. So we will see how to invoke the web service, okay, using a SOAP UI. And we'll see how to generate the client web service, and we can invoke the real web service also. We'll see how to write RESTful web services, and we'll see how to test the web services also. Okay. Any questions on web services, guys? I feel that this could be something new for you, for everyone, and it's again very interesting to learn. Okay. All right. So, what is your JNDI? Okay, so it's something like a naming and directory interface, wherein it's something like you do a lookup, right? Now, what do you do when you when you try to search for a person in your telephone directory, you do a lookup for the particular name, right? So what do you do? You do a lookup in that case. So JNDI is nothing but it's a kind of lookup, wherein you do a lookup and you try to get the details of that particular object. Okay, so this is with the help of JNDI, you kind of do a lookup to a particular resource. Okay, so this also we'll see in details. This is okay. Now, what is a JMS? Okay, JMS is nothing but your Java messaging service. Now, what is a Java messaging service? It is something like when I send you a message to your phone and your phone is switched off, right? So that message is not lost. What happens, that message is being saved somewhere in some place, okay? And the moment you switch on your phone, what happens? You consume that message, okay? So here in this case, you are a client, okay? And I'm the guy who is actually going to send the message to a particular place. Okay, and the moment you switch on your mobile, it could be something like you are on, okay, and you get the message from this place, okay, and even though you switched off and you switch on, in the meantime, if client one has already sent a request to the this queue, okay, you consume that message, okay. So we'll see even what JMS is, okay, and what is the JMS architecture. We'll see what is a queue and a topic, okay. Queue is something like you talk to one-to-one talk. Okay, topic is something like when you subscribe yourself to any of the news articles, what happens is whenever news article publishes a message Okay, it gets broadcasted to each and every person who has actually subscribed for that. Okay, so that is something like a topic. Okay, queue is something like one to one. You are sending an email to XYZ person. The email only goes to that XYZ person. Okay, so that is something here, queue. Okay, so we'll see in depth when we talk about the JMS also. So we'll be using your ActiveMQ. ActiveMQ is we'll be using this as a communication from your client, from your sender and receiver. Okay. So okay. So next is in this course we'll be learning about Log4j. So Log4j is nothing but you want to log something to some of the file of your application so that you can revisit that logs to understand to understand your data might be okay. Or let's say you have some of your conditions, or you have some flows in your code, and you are trying to log some timestamps. Okay, so you can use your Log4j. We'll see that also for logging. And we are going to use the JUnit testing, and this is one of the important part in Java, because unless until you test your code, your code is not complete. So how do you test your code? You can do something, your manual testing also, okay, or you can use your JUnit, this kind of a framework, which if you use it, it will be easier for you to test your application. Okay, and on top of that, we'll see what a version control is. If you see, when you write a code in your company, you check in the code. That means you keep the code in a central repository. Okay. Even in this course, we'll see how to check in and check out. We'll be creating a central repository wherein we are going to check in all the programs which we will be doing it on a daily basis, so that I don't have to send it across to you. You're going to check out that project on a daily basis. Okay. Okay. Again, this is just not a theory class. While understanding concept, we'll be doing some actual coding in this class also. Okay. So what else we provide to you? We provide interview tips and suggestions in the class. Interview tips, yes. When I teach you each and every topic, I will be telling you what are the important topics you have to concentrate on if you guys are looking out for an interview or looking out for a career in Java. Okay, I'll be telling, okay, this topic is very important and this could be the questions to be asked to you. Okay, so you have to answer it in this way. All right, so an unlimited mock interview, we'll be sending you mock interviews for questions, and we will be giving even personal suggestions on interviews and on the class assignments. And one more thing, student can attend the class multiple times and you pay only one time. So it's wonderful, I believe, right? And you'll be having your daily and weekly assignments and reviews, okay? And feasible batch timings, and we have got a vibrant H2K forum to post technical questions also, okay? Yep, and many more reasons we can write in a single slide, but again, it'll be too much, okay? Any questions, guys? Any questions, any concerns?
Yes, I'm not in a place where I can really address my questions.
I'm
not in a place I can address my questions at this time. Can I call you folks with my questions?
Yes, you can. You can. I mean, if you feel comfortable, you can even put this in the forum. We can. I can answer your questions as well.
Well, there's. I was curious about the schedule.
Okay.
I may have to travel, and I was curious about the assignments and the frequency of attendance. And if there's a gap, if there's a gap where you have to, for whatever reason, not attend, how do you pick it up again?
You can talk to Snigdhan back. She'll give you some idea on that and how to proceed for that. Okay.
Right. And I just call your general number to in order to do that?
Yes, you can do that.
Okay. What was the name, Snigdha?
Snigdha. Yes, Snigdha.
Okay.
Snigdha, if you can put on your number in the comment chat so that. Who's speaking right now, actually? I'm sorry.
Okay, this is Raj.
This is Raj. Okay, Srinivas, you can just post your number to Raj so that we can talk to you.
Yeah, I think they have my number already. They called me before, but I'd be happy to do that.
Great, yeah. That sounds good. Yeah, any other questions and concerns, guys, I'll be happy to address your questions here.
Hi, this is Krishna. Same thing regarding about the schedule, the particular batch time you mentioned is 6 p.m. PST time, right?
Could you please go ahead and answer the questions?
Okay, which location are you joining from, sir?
I logged from the PST time, Los Angeles.
Okay. If we do a batch at 9 o'clock Eastern time, it will be 6 o'clock for you.
Is it possible we can move 6:30?
That is 9:30, right?
Yeah,
we can do that. We can do that.
Thank you.
Hello.
Only if Jayram is comfortable with 9:30.
Yeah, because like EST, I'm in Boston, so EST time it will be like too late for us.
Okay. You know what, Krishna? We can work it out.
Okay.
Just call on the number mentioned, and we can have multiple batches run. So that is not a problem. We can manage it. Okay.
Okay.
Great, thanks, Nigda. All right, any other questions, guys? If not, thanks for attending this session.
Hi, Jayram.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Are you going to provide any videos? Like we can listen after the class also?
Yes, we are going to provide videos to you as well.
Okay, so when will this batch going to start?
This batch, again, Snigdha, you can get in touch with Snigdha for this. Okay.
Sure.
Yeah, please give us a call on the number mentioned below for any inquiries about batch schedules and pricing and stuff.
Okay, sure.
We can address your inquiries, okay?
Yeah, thank you.
You can even shoot out an email mentioned here.
Okay.
Yep, if no questions, guys, I'll be dropping off this call. Thank
you for the demo.
Right, thank you a lot for attending also.
Thank you, Jayram. Yeah, it was so nice.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks a lot, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you, Jayram. Bye.
Yeah, bye-bye.
So many of our students have given testimonials on how our training programs are. You will find them on kudzu.com and on our website, h2kinfosys.com. On our website h2kinfosys.com, you will also find more detailed information on who we are, the courses that we offer, what each course covers. Also, if you're interested in a demo program, please register on our homepage on the left-hand side. Just give us more information about yourself and we will send you a link for a demo class. The demo class is absolutely free. Experience our commitment by just attending an orientation workshop at no cost. Our team of faculty and advisors are here to guide you with the right information. If you still have more questions, please feel free to call us. Call us at 770-777-1269. This is a United States number. If you're calling from the UK, call us at 020-337-17615. You can also email us at training@h2kinfosys.com or h2kinfosys@gmail.com. Thank you for watching our videos. We wish you a great career in information technology.